Hey everyone, in this lesson we are going to talk about regulation of glycogen metabolism, and I request you to also watch my previous video on glycogenesis and glycogenolysis before you watch this lesson. So the most important reason for regulation of glycogen metabolism is to maintain blood glucose levels and also provide energy for exercising muscles. So in this particular lesson, we are going to talk about regulation of glycogen metabolism in specifically in two different conditions. One is fasting state and second is fed state. And most important thing we need to know that control of glycogen metabolism involves the reciprocal regulation of the activities of two important enzymes. Those enzymes are glycogen synthase and glycogen phosphorylase enzyme. So glycogen synthase is a rate limiting enzyme for glycogenesis, whereas glycogen phosphorylase enzyme is a rate limiting enzyme for glycogenolysis pathway. So during fasting condition, blood glucose level is low, which also result in the increase in the level of hormone, which is called glucagon, and as well as there is also an increase in the level of AMP. AMP is an indicator of energy deficient state in the cells. So during fasting state, both glycogen synthase and glycogen phosphorylase enzymes are phosphorylated. And when glycogen synthase enzyme is phosphorylated, it is considered to be inactive, and therefore the pathway of glycogenesis is inhibited. On the other hand, when glycogen phosphorylase enzyme is phosphorylated, it is considered to be active, and therefore the pathway of glycogenolysis is upregulated. Now let's talk about the fed state. So during fed state, there is an increase in blood glucose level, which also results in the increase in insulin hormone, as well as there is also an increase in the ATP levels. And increase in ATP level is an indicator of energy-rich status of the cells. So during fed state, both the enzyme, that is glycogen synthase and glycogen phosphorylase, are dephosphorylated. Dephosphorylated, that means the phosphate group is removed from both the enzymes. And when glycogen synthase enzyme is dephosphorylated, it is considered to be active, and hence the glycogenesis pathway is upregulated. Whereas when glycogen phosphorylase enzyme is dephosphorylated, it is considered to be inactive, and therefore the pathway of glycogenolysis is inhibited. So remember that glycogenesis is favored during fed state when blood glucose levels are high, which also result in the increase in insulin and ATP levels. And also one thing to remember that during fed state, both the enzymes are dephosphorylated, and when glycogen synthase is dephosphorylated, it is considered to be active, and glycogen phosphorylase enzyme, when it is dephosphorylated, it is considered to be inactive. Whereas glycogenolysis pathway is favored during fasting state when blood glucose levels are low, which also result in increase in glucagon level, as well as there is an increase in AMP level. And most importantly, during fasting state, both the enzymes are phosphorylated. So when glycogen synthase enzyme is phosphorylated, it is considered to be inactive. And when glycogen phosphorylase enzyme is phosphorylated, it is considered to be active. So now let's talk about how glycogen metabolism is regulated during fed condition. So as I mentioned that when glucose levels are high during fed state, the beta cells of the pancreas release insulin. So here we have insulin both in muscle and liver. So when insulin is released during fed state, it binds to its insulin receptor on the plasma membrane in both hepatocytes and muscle cells. So once insulin is bound to its insulin receptor, it activates the enzyme called protein kinase B. So once protein kinase B enzyme is activated, it inhibits another enzyme which is called glycogen synthase kinase 3. And this is a very important regulator of glycogen metabolism. So when glycogen synthase kinase 3, which is GSK3, when it is activated, it Since it is kinase, it phosphorylates glycogen synthase enzyme and inactivates the enzyme. Therefore, it actually inhibits the glycogenesis process. So basically, GSK3 negatively regulates glycogen synthase enzyme to inhibit glycogenesis pathway. So what protein kinase or PKB does, that PKB protein inhibits GSK3 by phosphorylating the enzyme. So when GSK3 is phosphorylated, it is considered to be inactive. Therefore, it is not able to phosphorylate glycogen synthase enzyme, and that will result in the upregulation of glycogenesis pathway. So remember that protein kinase B, PKB, inhibits glycogen synthase enzyme by phosphorylating GSK3. Now, PKB also phosphorylate another protein, which is called protein phosphatase 1 enzyme. So when protein phosphatase 1 or PP1 is phosphorylated, it is considered to be active. And since it is phosphatase, the role of phosphatase's enzymes are to remove the phosphate group. So phosphatase enzyme, PP1, dephosphorylate glycogen synthase enzyme. And when glycogen synthase enzyme is dephosphorylated, it is considered to be active, and this will further result in the activation of glycogenesis pathway, where then glucose is used to synthesize glycogen. Now, protein phosphatase 1 enzyme not only dephosphorylate glycogen synthase enzyme, but it also dephosphorylate glycogen phosphorylase enzyme, which is a rate limiting enzyme for glycogenolysis. So when glycogen phosphorylase enzyme is dephosphorylated, it is considered to be inactive, and therefore the pathway of glycogenolysis is inhibited. So you can see that these two enzymes are never activated at the same time. When glycogenesis pathway is upregulated, glycogenolysis pathway is inhibited. The red arrow here indicates the inhibition of the pathway. Now, glycogen synthase enzyme is also allosterically regulated. So when there's too much of glucose is converted into glucose 6-phosphate, and glucose 6-phosphate is then accumulated in the cells, it will allosterically activate glycogen synthase enzyme, and it will divert the glucose 6-phosphate into glycogenesis pathway to synthesize glycogen. Now, at the same time, glycogen phosphorylase enzyme is allosterically inhibited by ATP, glucose, and glucose 6-phosphate. So when glucose 6-phosphate is accumulated, not only it allosterically activate glycogen synthase enzyme, but it allosterically inhibit glycogen phosphorylase enzyme to inhibit glycogenolysis pathway. And ATP, which is an indicator of energy-rich cells, as well as glucose, both also can allosterically inhibit glycogen phosphorylase enzyme to inhibit glycogenolysis pathway. So this is the regulation of glycogen metabolism during fed state. So now let's talk about the regulation of glycogen metabolism during fasting state. So during fasting state, when blood glucose levels are low, the alpha cells of the pancreas release a hormone which is called glucagon, and this is only in the liver. So when glucagon is released, it binds to these G protein coupled receptors, and once it is bound to these G protein coupled receptors, it activates the adenyl cyclase enzyme. And once the adenyl cyclase enzyme is activated, it increases the cyclic AMP level, which is synthesized from ATP. So the increased cyclic AMP level subsequently activates the protein kinase A enzyme. And furthermore, the activated PKA activates the phosphorylase B kinase enzyme. And since PKA is a kinase, it activates phosphorylase B kinase enzyme by phosphorylating it. And this is an energy consuming process where ATP is converted into ADP. And subsequently, the phosphorylase B kinase, activated phosphorylase B kinase enzyme, then activates glycogen phosphorylase A enzyme, by phosphorylating it. And this is also an energy consuming process where ATP is converted into ADP. And we all know by now that a glycogen phosphorylase enzyme is a rate limiting enzyme for glycogenolysis pathway. So it subsequently then activates glycogenolysis pathway where glycogen is first converted into glucose 1-phosphate, and glucose 1-phosphate then in the liver it is then converted into glucose, and glucose which is synthesized here that is then released into the bloodstream. Now in the muscle, glucose 1-phosphate is then converted into glucose 6-phosphate, and glucose 6-phosphate is then enters into glycolysis pathway to synthesize energy in the form of ATP. Now there is another hormone which is called epinephrine, which is released by adrenal glands during periods of stress, and this also promotes the degradation of glycogen both in liver and muscle tissue via signaling cascade that is identical to that of glucagon. So epinephrine and glucagon both through G protein coupled receptor both promote glycogenolysis pathway or activate glycogenolysis pathway. However, one thing to remember that glucagon only upregulate glycogenolysis pathway in liver, whereas epinephrine is involved in upregulating glycogenolysis pathway both in liver and muscle. Now, glycogen phosphorylase enzyme is also allosterically regulated. So AMP, which is an indicator of energy deficient cell. So increase in AMP levels can also increase, can also allosterically activate the glycogen phosphorylase enzyme to upregulate glycogenolysis pathway to synthesize energy in the form of ATP through glycolysis. Furthermore, calcium is also considered to be an allosteric regulator of glycogenolysis pathway. So during intense exercise or during exercising muscle, when muscles are contracting, it releases a lot of calcium in the sarcoplasmic reticulum, and then this increased level of calcium can activate phosphorylase B kinase enzyme, which then subsequently activate the glycogen phosphorylase enzyme to upregulate glycogenolysis pathway to synthesize energy in the form of ATP. And then this energy is then being utilized by exercising muscle. So therefore, calcium play a very important role to upregulate glycogenolysis pathway to provide energy during exercising muscle. So this is an overview of how glycogenolysis pathway is upregulated during fasting state. Now let's talk about how glycogenesis pathway is inhibited during fasting state. So when protein kinase enzyme is activated, it phosphorylates and inactivates glycogen synthase enzyme, and we know that when glycogen synthase enzyme is phosphorylated, it is considered to be inactive, and therefore the glycogenesis pathway is inhibited. At the same time, pKa also activates inhibitor 1 protein. So when inhibitor 1 protein is activated, it inhibits protein phosphatase 1 enzyme, and when protein phosphatase enzyme 1 is inhibited, it is unable to dephosphorylate glycogen synthase enzyme to upregulate glycogenesis pathway. So because protein phosphatase enzyme is not able to dephosphorylate glycogen synthase enzyme, the glycogenesis pathway is inhibited. So this is the overview of regulation of glycogen metabolism both during fasting state and during fed state. So now let's quickly review the regulation of glycogen metabolism in liver and in muscle separately. So in liver, during fed state, increased levels of both insulin and glucose 6-phosphate activates glycogenesis pathway, whereas during fasting state, increased level of glucagon hormone inhibits glycogenesis pathway. So that is about glycogenesis. Now let's talk about glycogenolysis. So during fasting state, there is an increase in glucagon level, as well as during stressful condition, there is an increase in epinephrine hormone. So increased levels of both glucagon and epinephrine activates glycogenolysis, whereas during fed state, when glucose, insulin, glucose 6-phosphate and ATP levels are increased, that results in the inhibition of glycogenolysis pathway. And another important thing to remember that glycogen synthase enzyme, which is a rate limiting enzyme for glycogenolysis, it is activated when it is dephosphorylated, whereas when the enzyme is phosphorylated, it is considered to be inactive. Whereas glycogen phosphorylase enzyme, which is a rate limiting enzyme for glycogenolysis, so the enzyme is considered to be inactive when it is dephosphorylated, and the enzyme is considered to be active when it is phosphorylated. So this is the regulation of glycogen metabolism in liver. Now let's talk about glycogen metabolism, regulation of glycogen metabolism in muscles. So this is the glycogenesis pathway. And again, during fed state, both increased levels of insulin and glucose 6-phosphate can upregulate glycogenesis pathway. Whereas when you talk about glycogenolysis, during fasting state, when AMP levels are increased, which is an indicator of energy deficient state of the cell. So when AMP levels are increased, epinephrine levels are increased, as well as calcium levels, which is upregulated during exercising muscle. All this condition can upregulate glycogenolysis pathway. Whereas during fed state, when insulin level is increased, as well as glucose 6-phosphate and ATP levels are increased, that can result in the inhibition of glycogenolysis pathway in the muscle. So this is the difference between regulation of glycogen metabolism both in liver and in muscle. So I really hope that you learn something new from this video, and if you do so, please like and share the video and subscribe the channel. I will see you soon. Thanks so much for watching.